Doing. Woo! Okay, before we get started, we're going to have the throwing of the things. Please throw things.
I got a cup, it's hard, watch out.
All right, there we go. My name is Holt Sorensen. I'm one of the Shmoo. I hope things are going well for you at your con. We wish you a happy con, as always. New and prior year t-shirts are available for donation at registration. Get them now before we run out, and so we don't have to take them home. The party is tonight at 9 p.m. You have to enter from the terrace level and come down the stairs, so just follow the crowd to get to the party tonight. And do take some time to go down the other hallway and look at some of the other events that are going on over there, the Lockpick Village, Boffett, and all those other things. The talk that we're about to get started with is the state of secure messaging. And it's our speakers are Nikita Borisov and Zeshwin Tan. So please give them a hand and they'll go ahead and take it away. Thanks.
All right, thank you, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here and talk about the world of secure messaging. So one thing before we start, Sesren is going to be here with his laptop. If you come up with questions while we're talking, feel free to tweet it at us, and we'll either respond to them after the talk, or maybe Sesren will respond to them in real time. So, and of course, we'll try to leave some time for questions at the end. Okay, so before I talk about the state of secure messaging today, I want to take you on a little bit of a story. It's a personal story, and it has to do with a tool called Pretty Good Privacy. How many of you have used PGP out here? Okay, how many of you have used PGP in the last month? Okay, that's actually a lot more than I thought. So anyway, PGP was a tool that I discovered in the early 90s. And I was excited. I was like a kid in a candy store. Here was something that I could download that could use this fancy cryptography to protect my email messages from all sorts of adversaries. So the first thing I did is I ran out. I created my very first PGP key that is looking at the date here, it's a little bit older than some of the people here, as well as some of the people on stage. I put in my FidoNet point address into it, and I started exchanging email with all of my friends and sending them back and forth. I even got involved in key signing parties, which, by the way, is my favorite Wikipedia disambiguation page that you will ever see. So PGP, at least back then, was really founded, so that you see this little key that says 1024R next to the key ID. And this says that this is a 1024-bit RSA key. So RSA is, of course, a well-known cryptographic algorithm. It's been famous enough to have been put on many t-shirts and other places like that. This is a really quick explanation of it if you haven't seen it before, but you can find, you know, any sort of web page textbook and so forth will give you this type of explanation of RSA. Now, you might be cringing at the Comic Sans in this slide. This was done on purpose. This is actually really a comic book version of RSA. This is not how to implement RSA securely, so that's not the point of this talk to teach you how to do secure RSA. But the main thing is that it allows you to do this really interesting thing using public key cryptography. So you're able to encrypt a message using somebody's public key and then have them use their private key to decrypt it. And you also had this really neat idea where you could do digital signatures. You could sign a message using your private key, and then somebody using your public key could verify that you have signed it. And so I used this technology to exchange messages with my friends all the time. And sometime later, I started thinking a little bit about, well, is this the right set of tools for the kind of a conversation that I want to have? And so I took a step back and we started thinking about, well, what is it like when you have a conversation with somebody in private, in person? This is what we'd like to imitate as much as possible. And so in person, if I, you know, have a conversation with Sichuan here in our hotel room, for example, each of us knows who is talking, right? I am pretty sure that when Sichuan was telling me about his slides this morning, it was Sichuan and not some imposter in a Sichuan suit. And likewise, we also know who is listening, because there's two of us in the hotel room, and then, I don't know, it's just DC, so maybe there's bugs, but hopefully not. You can get this sense of confidentiality in a conversation. This is something that PGP is quite good at. It allows you to encrypt a message, so you know that only the person who has the right private key is listening. It allows you to sign a message to know that only the person who had the private key was able to generate this message, so you know who is talking. But the other thing is that conversations are also ephemeral. So when we talk in our hotel room, there is, I hope, no record of this conversation. There's nothing that can be looked at later on that can show somebody else what was said when. And there's no proof. I can't decisively prove to you what Sichuan told me this morning. You'd have to take my word for it. And if you look at what PGP was providing, it was providing actually very different properties. So let's look at signatures first. So digital signatures are a nice way to authenticate a message, but it's really a very heavy-handed way of doing this authentication, because signatures are implicitly, they're verifiable by anybody in the world. So they really are like signatures you would put on a contract or the signatures on the Declaration of Independence that you see here. They're intended to make a statement to the world that you're willing to stand behind and that other people can show to third parties and say, yes, Nikita signed this message. This is, in fact, Nikita's official position. Now, if I'm just sitting in a hotel room and chatting away, I'm not typically trying to think of my official position. I just want Sichuan to know something. I don't want to make this kind of statement. And we can see how the existence of these signatures can lead people into trouble. Here, it's a little bit small font, so you might not be able to see, but this is something called a DKIM signature on an email message that was posted to WikiLeaks from the Democratic National Committee. So this is a little header with an RSA signature that is generated by your mail provider, and it's used to combat spam. It's used to prove that this was generated by the authoritative server for a particular email domain and not a spammer trying to masquerade as this message. And so what this means is that if you take a message that was leaked, such as this one where there was apparently some advanced questions provided to Hillary Clinton, anybody can go and verify that this message was in fact authenticated by the mail server. In this case, the authentication doesn't come from an individual, but it comes from Google's mail servers that were used to relay this message. And this is an interesting fact because at the time that this message came forward, the author of the message being replied to, Donna Brazil, made a statement saying, well, who knows if these are in fact the real messages? Nobody can verify that WikiLeaks got the right messages and didn't modify them, or they weren't modified before they got to WikiLeaks. But in fact, Rob Graham, a security researcher, in fact went and did a very simple test and showed that there was a digital signature here, and the only way this could have been modified is if somebody had broken into Google servers that are used to relay this message. Right? So you have this very long-lasting signature that can be used to prove hold you to a message much longer than you were hoping to. This is really a conversation that everybody on this email would have preferred stayed private. Now, turning to the question of saying, is there a record of the communication? So when we send traffic over the internet, there's very little to prevent somebody from being able to snoop, download, record it, and so forth. So our hope is that even though there might be records of it, because it goes through lots of places where people can record them, that record is not really useful to anybody. And the reason it's not useful is because the message cannot be decrypted without a private key. But this, of course, relies on this private key being held secure. And if that private key ever leaks, ever is stolen, ever your computer is ever compromised, you lose the key somehow, and so forth, the information can then be recovered. So if somebody found this 25-year-old private key that I created, and for all I know, someone has. I actually have no idea where that key is. You know, it was on some hard drive on some computer that I haven't seen in decades, right? I don't know what happened to it. Somebody could recover the messages and find out, you know, who I had a crush on in high school and all things like that. So the PGP model of protecting your messages wasn't really a good fit for the kind of conversations I was hoping to have. And so this led me to design with my collaborator Ian Goldberg something we called off-the-record messaging. And so I'll tell you a little bit about the protocols that are involved here and how they've evolved since we first created them. So a foundational tool for our communication infrastructure is something called a Diffie-Hellman key exchange, invented by Whit Diffie and Martin Hellman. Oh, whoops, I think this is the wrong picture of Whit Diffie. That's the right one. And it's a very simple protocol. You come up with two secret numbers. So Diffie comes up with a secret number A, Hellman comes up with a secret number B. They exchange G to the A and G to the B, and they compute the shared secret, G to the AB, which is equal to G to the BA. And the nice thing is that if you do this in the right type of mathematical structure where it's difficult to compute logarithms, then somebody who just watches this exchange can't tell what the shared secret is, even though they saw all the messages go back and forth. So this allows you to do something called, achieve something called forward secrecy. So if I'm talking to somebody, I generate my secret A, I perform a Diffie-Hellman key exchange, I use the shared secret to then generate some other symmetric encryption key that I use with a symmetric algorithm such as the AES advanced encryption standard that is used, the standard symmetric algorithm used today, and I encrypt messages using that. And then, very importantly, once I'm done with a conversation, I forget those keys. I forget A, and I forget this K sub E, the encryption key. And now, anybody who has a record of this data, and anybody who has any sort of long-term key material I have, is still unable to recover this data because this key piece of information, this secret A, was only used for a short lifetime of the session, and then forgotten, and then now it's lost to the sands of time, and so is the contents of the conversation. We can also do authentication. We can prove who talked to whom without signatures, or without signatures on the message, rather. So this is the key exchange that we came up with, is that you do your Diffie-Hellman key exchange, and you put a signature on the key exchange messages themselves. So I send a message to Shmoocon and I say, here is my G to the A, and here I sign it with my key. And he sends me one G to the B, and he signs it with his key. So now we know that we're talking to each other. We know that we computed a shared secret that's known only to us. And we can use this shared secret now to generate something called a message authentication code. And this is a symmetric keyed digest of a message that can be used to verify that nobody has tampered with it, but can't be used to prove to any third party that something has happened. There's two things that are standing in your way. First is that because this key is symmetric, both Sichuan and I know it. So Sichuan can't go and show to somebody else saying, well, Nikita said this, here's this map that he's generated. And likewise, I can't say anything, because he could have generated this map himself. And in fact, to make this even more deniable, what we do is, after the session is over, we just publish this key, because we've already finished our conversation, we no longer have a use for it, and rather than forget it, this key, as we would for the encryption key, we publish it, we just throw it out as part of the chat transcript, and now anybody could have generated a message with a correct authentication tag. And so this gives us a property we call deniability. Now, I should say, since we designed this, I've had a number of conversations with people about deniability. And deniability is not a get-out-of-jail-free card, right? It's not something that's, it's not the case that unless somebody can find cryptographic proof that you wrote somebody, it's the only way people will believe that you wrote something. In some sense, this whole situation with the domain keys and authentication of the messages was a bit of a sideshow to the DNC email scandal. Only, you know, the super geeky people like us said, well, I wonder if you could authenticate this, and I wonder if the messages have been tampered with. There was a lot of damage that was caused to the DNC by the leaks, even before any cryptographic proof was found. So it's not going to save you but from people believing that you wrote something. But it is going to prevent them from finding this additional mathematical constraint that shows you that the that it allows you to verify for sure that something happened. So this is something that works on a scale of a session, and the but if you talk about various messaging protocols, sessions can last a long time. I can have a chat with my wife that really, you know, responds to messages. You know, she goes to bed in Illinois, I wake up in DC, I send a reply to her last message. We might have day-long conversations over message chats. So it would be even better if we could get these privacy properties, these deniability and forward secrecy properties faster. And so we invented something that's since become called the ratchet. And the idea is that, well, as I explained to you, we derive a key from a shared secret. We derive an encryption key and an authentication key and use it to send a message. When ratchet sends a message to Clank here, in addition to the message that he includes, he adds a little next half of a new Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So he picks a new A1 and includes it in the message. Now, Clank over here can combine his half of the Diffie-Hellman, of the first Diffie-Hellman key exchange, with Ratchet's new A1 to derive a new shared key. And from that, he can derive his new set of keys and send a message back using this new shared secret. And then, at the same time, move things one step forward by coming up with a new key himself. To see how this works in a few steps, we can say, well, we start by using our secret G to the AB. We send a new G to the A1. Then Clank uses the secret G to the A1B and picks a new secret B1 and sends that over. Now, at this point, Ratchet can securely forget the secret A that was used to create the previous shared secret, because he knows that Clank has received his new A1, and A is no longer useful. And so after a single message exchange, That is now forgotten. But note that Clank at this point still has to keep his half of the secret B, because he doesn't know that there aren't any other messages that he is about to receive that might use his original B. And only after the next message sent by Ratchet can Clank forget his B. And it's at this point that we have forward secrecy for the very first message. So there is this nice property that we can get forward secrecy, but it takes a few steps before we get there. There's actually a somewhat simpler way of achieving forward secrecy, which is it's rather than doing this Diffie-Hellman key exchange, you can ratchet using just a hash function, where what you do is you take your current key, your shared key that you share with the two parties, and you apply a hash function to it that is irreversible. You can compute a function. It's easy to compute one way, but it's hard to invert it. From K1, you can derive K2, but knowing K2, you can derive K1. The nice thing is that it's a lot easier to synchronize. So if Ratchet sends M1 over here, he can immediately compute K2 and use it for all future messages and forget K1. And as soon as Clank receives the first message, he can immediately compute K2 as well. And at this point, both of them have gotten K1, and so we're straight away, after just sending a single message, that context of the message is now securely protected from anybody else, rather than waiting for future exchanges. So this is nice, but this has a different problem, which is that you don't have very good what's called compromise recovery. Or sometimes it's called future secrecy, and sometimes it's called backward secrecy. And the terms, I find them personally very confusing. But in any case, the idea is that if somebody were to find out one of these keys at some point in time, just somehow discovers, let's say, K2, how might they do this? Maybe there's some side channel that they're able to, you know, there's some other application on your phone that monitors some execution timings and is able to recover. Maybe you generated insufficient randomness. Maybe this key accidentally got written to disk or swapped out. As soon as you have one of these keys, you can then project it forward and get all of the future keys that were derived from it. So essentially, the whole thing here rests on forgetting every single key as securely as possible. The Diffie-Hellman ratchet doesn't have this problem. Diffie-Hellman, because you do a new exchange, even if somebody knows your current key, they won't be able to derive the next one because they need this new secret part that's being generated. Where here, no new secret sauce is being mixed in. And so this was then combined into something that used to be called axolotl, but has recently been renamed a double ratchet protocol. And it is used in the signal protocol, which you can install on your phone. So it essentially combines Diffie-Hellman ratchet, which is here on the right, with several ratchets that are used on I guess your left, maybe the other way around. The Diffie-Hellman ratchet is on the left, and the other ratchets are on the right, that are advanced more quickly. So when messages are sent, you immediately advance the symmetric key ratchets, and you're able to forget old keys. And then periodically, you do this Diffie-Hellman ratchet, and you advance this ratchet in order to provide compromise recovery. And so together, what happens is that all of the symmetric ratchet pieces get forgotten very quickly as soon as they're used, essentially. The only thing that you see here are inside green circles are the only things that are maintained after the ratchet is complete. And so, like I said, this is what's used in a single protocol, which is now deployed in a lot of commercial systems, including Facebook messaging, WhatsApp, and Google's Allo Messenger, though in Google it's only opt-in. So let me talk about next about key distribution. So this protocol allows you to have a really nice and private conversation, assuming that you know the public keys of who you're talking to. How do you do this? Well, you could go and manually essentially verify. You could go up to somebody and say, what is your key? Or maybe you create a Solhal digest. You can exchange it using your QR code. You can use something that was built into a newer version of OTR called a Socialist Millionaires Protocol, where what you can do is you can verify that the person you're talking to is using the same key as you by being able to agree on a short, relatively more guessable secret. And the Socialist Millionaires Protocol has a property that uses something called zero-knowledge proofs to create a situation where the protocol will succeed if and only if you and your buddy have the same secret and are using the same key. But if you don't, the only thing that is revealed through the protocol is that your secrets are different. The values of the secrets never come out. And so, in particular, it's impossible for somebody to then try to take guesses as to what your secret might be. And so, this is something that can be used. But in practice, if you look at the deployed systems like Facebook Messenger or Google Allo, the way that you get these keys is actually you get them from the server. And the problem here is that it's twofold. One is that you have to trust the server to give you the correct key. The second is that the keys change over time. So you create a key on your phone, and then you wake up the next morning and you discover that your phone was a Samsung Galaxy S7 and then it caught fire overnight. Now you have to create a new key and then go through this whole process again. You have to go figure out, exchange fingerprints for your friends, or you have to go and come up with a new secret for your social mailing protocol, and so forth. Now, to make it easier for people, the applications like WhatsApp have these nice tools that say, well, if you just get a new phone, we can add a new key to your protocol, to your account, and inform everybody else that you're chatting with that now there's a new key that is being used. The other nice thing is that your application, when receiving this key, will also say, oh, incidentally, do I have any messages that my friend hasn't received yet? And if so, I'm going to go and re-encrypt them with the new key and send them out again. And usability perspective, this is very nice because it's completely transparent. But from a security perspective, this becomes a problem because who tells you that there's a new key? The central server belonging to WhatsApp. Who tells you that the message was delivered or wasn't delivered? Once again, the central server belonging to WhatsApp. So very quickly, it becomes possible for the server to, at any point, decide, you know, I'm going to just create a new key for Nikita and read any messages that people have recently tried to send to him. In theory, you could try to warn people that this key was added to your account. But the problem is that I could go and query WhatsApp and say, what kind of keys have you been telling people that I have? And the WhatsApp server says, oh, just the one you told me about. I'm not telling people about any other keys. But of course, when Mr. Chuen says, he says, oh, no, Nikita has this new phone that he got, so please use that one. So the problem here is that there's a possibility for what's called equivocation. The WhatsApp server can tell Mr. Chuen one thing about my key store and tell me something else. There's this nice technology that's kind of up and coming called key transparency that is Google just put out a new GitHub release of it that tries to prevent this kind of equivocation by essentially taking a hash of this key store, making sure that only appends things rather than than creates just removes old data, and then whenever we talk, my friends and I will exchange this hash. We'll gossip between each other to make sure that we're seeing the same thing. So as long as you can't be man in the middle all of the time, at some point any equivocation will be discovered. And so this is, I think, an interesting way to bridge this problem, but it's not quite deployed at any system that I know of yet. So the third thing I want to talk about is metadata. So metadata, in this case, is information about whoever is talking to whom and when. So all these protocols are able to hide from any observer what the contents of the messages are, but they don't hide the fact that messages are sent, and they don't hide the fact of who you talk to in the first place. And if you stick around for another 25 minutes or so, then or half an hour, rather, then you'll see an excellent talk by Professor Matt Blaze that discusses the difficulties of having metadata be available for other people to observe and examine. So what can we do to try to limit the amount of metadata that can be created? So a couple of years ago, Ian Goldberg, George Dineses, and I came up with a system we call DP5, that stands for Dachstuhl Privacy Preserving Presence Protocol, that is able to exchange online information, online presence information, between your friends without revealing your friendship relationships or even your online status to the servers that maintain them. And there are two basic tricks to DP5. I won't be able to really explain it in much detail today, but I do refer to you. Ian and George gave an excellent talk at 31C3 that you can find on YouTube that describes DP5 in a great amount of detail. But I'll tell you about the two kind of key pieces that are involved in DP5. One is that your identity, your name, is something that changes in a secret way every minute, let's say. In DP5, we divide time into epochs. And so every minute, you pick a new identity in a way that your friends who share some secret with you can discover what this identity will be, but nobody else can link them together. And you register yourself as being online in a database under this identity. You also register some auxiliary data, like how to find yourself, or maybe a message. Additionally, when people go to query this database, we use a technology called private information retrieval, or PIR, to be able to fetch the records inside this database that belong to your friends without the server learning which records you are after. And so this is an interesting cryptographic technique. There are many different ways of achieving it. And like I said, if you're interested in seeing how it works, it was actually explained pretty well in the 3.1.c3 talk. But the long and short of it is that when you get this information out from the server, the server doesn't know what you're looking for. So when you register, the registration is done with random IDs that make no sense to the server. And when somebody queries your online information, that is also doesn't give the server any information. And so the server is not able to collect usable metadata. And now I'm going to take a quick break from coughing, and Shmoocon is going to talk about the integration that he's doing of GP5 with Tor and XMPP.
Right, so GP5 hasn't really seen a widespread adoption, partly because there really isn't a tool for end users to start using it. So over the past few months, we have mocked up a prototype that integrates GP5 into the XMPP or the formerly Jabber protocol that actually makes use of this metadata query system. So this is just a brief diagram of how it works. So the idea is that you can use a regular, plain, vanilla Jabber client and Jabber server. And basically, we have a transparent proxy that goes between it. We'll have a short demo later on. You'll have to configure your Jabber client to go through it. And what this does is that whenever you start your XMPP session, every time you login, what it does is it generates a random temporary username on demand and registers it with the GP5 servers. So as Nikita have covered, so the GP5 service actually has properties where the server maintainers would not be able to know which records you're looking up, and hence you effectively constructing a social graph that can't be discovered by anyone other than two parties. So we have a demo that the idea is to, it's still a rough prototype, but the idea is we want to get people excited about GP5 and we want to see it more widely adopted. Yeah, I think it is. Okay, so I'm going to try to play it like simultaneously. Okay, so on your screen right now, what you're seeing is we're effective launching a proxy, and we're using a plain Jabber client. This is ADM on Mac. So obviously, we're verifying our fingerprint. This is self-signed cert. So what we're doing is we are proxying the TLS connection. So we are still connecting to the XMPP server via TLS. And what we're doing is we are auto-registering a random username in band without the user involvement for every session, and we are doing this for a second username, Bob. So we're registering the username, and if you hold on a moment, you would see that they would start exchanging that random username via GP5. So this is a process that ensures that the GP5 servers would not be able to learn that Alice and Bob are friends, and hence we are not leaking that metadata to a centralized service. So once we have that, we'll switch over real quick. So not too sure if you caught the previous slide, but essentially what we have to do is we have to wait for the next epoch. So the epoch currently in our configuration is at 30 seconds. So there will be a maximum wait of 30 seconds before you would discover the other user's username. So this isn't such a large issue simply because we are actually doing this only once per session, but in the future, it's definitely something that we'll want to do to decrease the length of the epoch and to switch out the usernames even more frequently. So all of this is going through Tor, so it will be non-trivial. It will be less. It will be more difficult to be able to identify and correlate the usernames, since every session will have its own circuit. This is where OTR works and everything. So it's the only thing that we're changing here is we're actually substituting the regular username with the random username, and everything else works fine between the clients without any server-side intervention. All right, so yeah, let me switch out from this. Okay, so these are things that you can do to help us grow this DP5 adoption. So we have, I'll post a link on the Twitter later on, and I would show it at the end slide. But what we really want is for people to try out the tool. It's still a rough prototype that we just mocked up over the past few months, few weeks. Yeah, and so we want people to start using it to get to know it, and to we want it to be adopted by more systems. If you are someone that has the capacity to run a DP5 server, it is a little resource intensive, but if you have the capacity, we want to encourage you to run it. We have a Docker Hub build that you can just pull. Check out the GitHub repo for details. You can just pull and run it, and it generates the certificates via Let's Encrypt automatically. So we want you to run such services and to help us grow the ecosystem, because having more servers would reduce the likelihood of collusions. And if you are XMPP server maintainers, one of the things that we are noticing is that many of them have very long trotters for in-band registration. Most of them had it set at 5 minutes, and this is a usability issue to DB5 users, simply because we have to auto-register a new username per session, and if you have to try more than once within a span of 5 minutes, it's a usability issue that we want to address. So if you're running one, come talk to us about how it impacts abuse management as well. And if you're an organization that it would be interested in such a tool, come talk to us as well, and we'll figure out how we can increase the adoption. So I'm going to pass the time back to Nikita, who would be talking about a alternative to combat the leakage of metadata, which is Ricochet.
All right, so I just want to kind of close by talking about one last system called Ricochet. Ricochet is another system that shares the goals of our project with this DP5 proxy, which is being able to communicate without revealing metadata. Ricochet is pretty heavily based on the Tor network. And I'll give you a sketch of how it operates, and once again, there's I'm happy to talk to you a little bit later about some of the details and point you in the right direction. So Ricochet operates by having a person, when they sign in, create something called a Tor location hidden service. And this is an endpoint in the Tor network that is anonymous and that other people can connect to. So the Tor network allows you to anonymously connect to other websites, as in a normal private operation, but hidden services allow you to operate essentially a website that other people can connect to without revealing where you are. And so Alice here would need to register with the hidden service directory and describe her location in an anonymized way. When her friend Bob wants to talk to her, he would need to look up her identifier in this hidden service directory. And both his analysis connections to the directory are protected and made anonymous through the Tor network. And then after this lookup happens, there is a couple of extra steps that I didn't want to elaborate here. But in the end, what happens is that they identify a rendezvous point, and they both create tunnels to that point, and then they're able to exchange messages back and forth. And so note here that there's nobody here who sees where Alice is, where Bob is, and nobody can tie them together because all of the communications are with anonymous endpoints. One difference between how Ricochet operates and how the DP5 system would operate, assuming that you're connecting with a DP5 proxy via Tor to an XMPP server, is that in Ricochet, it's possible to do, some traffic analysis to try to figure out who is connecting to which hidden services when by compromising some of the directory servers and some of the entry nodes in the Tor network. How hard is that to do? Well, the FBI did this very same thing to recover the identity of the Silk Road server that was seized a few years back. And the reason it's not super difficult is because all you need to do is you need to create a server and say, I'd like to join the Tor network. And if your server is reliable and doesn't have any problems, you become one of these onions or one of these directory servers. And over time, with enough servers, it is possible to carry out these kind of attacks. With Ricochet, once you are able to carry out these attacks, you then can start doing correlation on long-lived identifiers that are created that correspond to the hidden service names. With the DP5 proxy scenario, what you really need to do is you need to compromise the XMPP server and then start doing traffic analysis on these short-lived identifiers. These identifiers change in our current implementation every session, but potentially they can change even more often. So a single connection, you could periodically create a new identity and register that online and have even potentially multiple identities that exist at the same time. So something that is a subject of our research right now is trying to identify how well this kind of traffic analysis can perform. On the Ricochet side, there are improvements being made to the Tor network to make it more secure in terms of making the hidden service infrastructure more secure and less susceptible to attack, and also detecting attacks where somebody joins a bunch of new servers to it, something called a Sybil attack, to try to compromise a significant chunk of the Tor network. But in some sense, the security of these things is something that is a work in progress. So let me just quickly wrap up, and then we'll take questions. The signal protocol gives you very nice conversation properties that more closely mimic the personal conversations that we all have. It is now slowly taking over the world. It's been incorporated in a bunch of services like WhatsApp, Facebook Messengers, Google Allo, though in the latter case, it's only opt-in. The OTR protocol still exists and it still has quite a number of users. We are working on a new revision of it, but it will incorporate some of the ideas from Signal as well as some extra deniability and authentication protocol. Key distribution it still is a big challenge because you have this trade-off between being able to allowing people to just change their keys and have new devices all the time and the security that needs to exist for people to be able to make sure that the keys are authentic. And key transparency might make a big change here. So it's one space that I think needs to be watched in the near future. And then, as we'll see very soon, metadata is kind of the next frontier that really must be protected. I think these new efforts like DP5 and Ricochet can help, but also something that is going on in the research community is thinking about how to prevent traffic analysis so that these kind of long-term attacks don't work as much. So thank you very much. And I don't know, I think we've got time for a couple questions. All right, we got a couple of tweeted questions. Let me repeat those real fast. So Nick Sullivan asks, what will be the impact of key transparency on PGP? That's a good question. I really have a hard time seeing PGP becoming much more popular than it is now, even with key transparency. So. But perhaps it would allow for some types of integrations. Key transparency is not really tied to any one messaging protocol, I should say. And so it can be used with PGP type solutions for email as well as Signal and OTR type solutions for instant messaging. Another question by Jack Avagan for why hasn't truly decentralized secure messaging like RetroShare taken off? Actually, I'm not super familiar with RetroShare, so maybe you can explain it to me after of the talk. But one of the things, there was a talk or short acceptance speech given by Moxie Marlene Spike, one of the creators of the Signal protocol, for receiving an award for practical cryptography. And the issue is that he pointed out that it's significantly difficult to scale protocols to decentralized protocols to large user populations, in part because a large part of investment that goes into a protocol such as WhatsApp or Facebook Messenger is the support of making it usable by billions of users who have all sorts of problems using it, who have all sorts of questions, and who don't really understand cryptography. So one of the trade-offs that you talked about is, in fact, making it invisible, which is a trade-off that WhatsApp has made, but that makes this attack that I talked about possible. So I think one of the things, that said, he said, and I agree very much, that it doesn't mean that we should give up on the idea of decentralized messaging, but it is a fundamentally harder problem for making it scale and reach a large user population. All right, I think we have to stop.